We're having a family photograph taken. I tell the girls to wear their nice clothes and to brush their hair. They come downstairs and Bear is in a black t-shirt, faded to grey in the wash. She tells me it counts as her nice clothes. I want to argue, but I don't like my chances. Both girls are cross. They have other things to do, and there's a fierce debate about whether the dog should be in the family portrait or not. The dog's refusal to come in from the backyard, where there's a bone she's interested in, settles the matter. And Russell's shirt has a stain, so he has to get changed, and it feels like I'm the only one taking this seriously. I've arranged for a friend of ours, a photographer, to come to the house a week after we told the girls about the cancer. Bear asks me why it's suddenly so urgent, and I say to her lightly that there's no urgency at all. I've just realised that we don't have a nice photo of the four of us. The photo is a portrait of a man and his children, and me, his wife and their mother, who wanted to capture a moment before it all went wrong. This photo is my evidence that we were okay once and perhaps would be again. And if we were never okay again, at least I'd remember the moment before it all happened. I'm Sophie Townsend, and this is Goodbye to All This, an original podcast from the BBC World Service. This is Chapter 3, Family Portrait. A week after we take that photo, treatment begins. It's crisp, but not cold. As if there is some agreement between us and the weather to hold on to autumn as long as we can. The trees are still hanging on to those few red and golden leaves, the rest mostly blown to the ground, crunchy underneath. Hold on, we think. Hold on. At the cancer centre, the patients look scared and submissive. When Russell's name is called, we rise together. Well, he says, I guess this is where the rubber hits the road. Russell has stage 3B lung cancer. It's an approximately 25% survival rate, according to what I've seen online. One in four. And someone's got to be the one, don't they? The oncology registrar, who we see today, smiles gently and tells me not to Google. He goes through the treatment plan again. It goes in 3-week cycles. A dose of a very strong chemotherapy drug, big guns, the registrar says, in the first week, and a gentler, more standard drug the week after that, like a sort of booster. Then a rest week. This is the first week of the first cycle, and there'll be 4 all up, 12 weeks in all. Each treatment, Russell needs to be weighed and his bloods have to be taken. We're told that this will all seem very familiar and run-of-the-mill soon, but today it's confusing and we waste time not knowing quite what to do. The nurses are very nice about it, and we like them. One of them brings him tea in a plastic cup, weak and lukewarm. We thank her, and mean it. Throughout the treatment, he's consistently polite with the nurses. He asks them how their day is, tells them he thinks they're doing a good job. He tells them he's grateful to them. I'm grateful too. Genuinely, because they're kind and funny and they know exactly what's what. But for purely pragmatic reasons, I'm always on my best behaviour. That first day, I watched another patient, a man who's scared and in pain, who shouts at the nurses and treats them like incompetent servants, and I'm not sure they're quite as kind with him as they are with us. It's better to be nice to the nurses and not to complain about the time it's taking. It takes a lot of time. If we hadn't quite understood just how toxic the chemo drug he's been given is, we get a hint when the nurse, before preparing his drip, steps into a type of hazmat suit, full body protective gear with a mask covering her mouth, and carefully hitches the sealed bag of chemotherapy solution to the drip with fully gloved hands. Most of the IV bags I see round the ward are clear, but this one's black. Russell jokes it really just needs a skull and crossbones, and then squeezes my hand, the only way to tell me he's frightened. And then they put the needle, attached to a tube, attached to the IV bag, into his vein, and it starts to enter his body. And once it begins, all of a sudden, you might easily forget how brutal this is. As he sits in a big reclining chair, sun streaming through the window, I read a magazine. He closes his eyes. We don't talk much. Someone brings us both a cup of tea and biscuits. We thank them again. It takes maybe a day or two for the treatment to do its damage. He can't eat or drink. He sweats and shivers and he smells sour and metallic. The smell of food makes him vomit. And we're supposed to keep this up for the next 12 weeks and I wonder how. I ring the cancer centre, frightened on the fourth day when I realise he hasn't drunk anything for 24 hours. They tell me that what he really needs is to come in and to be hooked up to a bag of saline to be rehydrated. I ask when we can do this and they tell me they don't have room. They're sympathetic, but there are no beds. They offer me instead a recipe. 6 level teaspoons of sugar and a half level teaspoon of salt dissolved in 1 litre of cooled, boiled water for him to sip at. He takes small mouthfuls and snaps at me when I encourage him to take more. Then he throws up. And that's week one. Week one out of 12. And we thought this would be doable, but now we're not sure. And we thought he'd go back to work in the weeks he wasn't having the chemo, but he's so done in and so ill that he never goes back into work. Stays inside as the house gets colder and he gets thinner, less sure of himself. He is sure of his doctors, sure that they'll save him. He's sure of his girls and of me. But I see him lose confidence every day in his place in the world as he sits on the couch, the rest of us moving around him. It's a month since we took the family portrait. In the photo, I look less tired than I do these days. These days, I go to work and I help the girls with their homework and I'm as cheerful as I can be. I keep life as normal as possible. as I'm making protein shakes on the days he can manage it and shuttle the girls to weekend activities. I'm so tired, and I want to be with Russell and the girls as much as I can, but the neighbourhood mums insist on taking me out for a drink, and it's a relief to sit and laugh and talk.
And the conversation was about Russell and how things were going, and I remember you getting really upset, saying, I can't do this, I can't do this. And one of the other women putting her arm around you saying, yes, you can, and you will, you don't have a choice, you will do it and you'll be great.
They walk me home, and when I get in, I hold each of the girls as they lie in their beds. And then I lie next to Russell and watch him sleep. As I leave the house to go to work each morning, after telling Russell I'm just a phone call away and telling him what's in the fridge for lunch, if he could just try it, and I'm rushing the kids out the door because I don't want to be late, the man who walks the dog arrives at the gate. No matter how rushed I look, he's always up for a chat. He says he prays for us every night. I'm very fond of the dog walker, a man with a serious limp and a love of God, who walks three or four neighbourhood dogs of varying sizes and breeds round the streets while their owners are out at work. We pay him, but he'd do it for free. He loves all the dogs, but he especially loves Katie, and she's devoted to him. I'm not a believer and I don't pray, but I thank him. He tells me that Russell is the most handsome man in Glebe, that the only man more handsome is sweet Jesus himself. I tell him that I know he says this about all the men in Glebe, and he laughs and tells me that it's true about Russell. As I ask the girls if they've remembered their lunches and shout out my final goodbye to Russell, the dog walker tells Katie it's time for her walk and leads her out of our front gate slowly, his limp more pronounced than usual. He turns back to me and says, I'm sure that praying for you will help. I want to help. Everyone wants to help. There's something difficult and confusing about it, and I'm getting less and less able to accept kindnesses in a way that makes life easier. People offer to cook meals and I say yes, and sometimes two turn up at once. And I double book the children's play dates so that there's always a disappointed little friend somewhere whose parents have to explain that I have a lot on my mind at the moment and get things confused. Often these children look at me when they see me dropping off the kids at school, and I'm aware they think I'm a bit stupid. People offer to help and I don't know how to accept it. And my friends, women like Nicola who wanted to help, watched on, not knowing where to begin.
Everyone wanted to help and do something. I don't have a lot of confidence in my cooking, so I was reluctant to offer to cook. It's very hard because you worry that you're going to say the wrong thing or do the wrong thing.
And then the mother of a little boy at school says to me that she wants to help. And I hardly know her, and I feel like it's too much, another offer of help. Because the help is vital, but it's hard to know what to do with it sometimes. Because everyone wants to take the children, and everyone wants to do the shopping, and everyone wants to do something. And I either say yes to it all or no to it all, and I never know whether we've got food in the house or where the children might be. So I tell this woman that I appreciate her offer, but I can't take it up because things are hard enough already. And so she asks me for a cup of coffee, and she brings some paper and a pen, and She's a genius, really. She takes notes of all the things we need and the schedule of treatment and all my friends' email addresses. She goes home and draws up a calendar, and she organises a troop of people to do all the things we can't. People still bring round dinners, but now it's only one at a time, and they're brought around in takeaway containers so we don't have to think about bringing dishes back. She makes sure there are people to help get the kids to school on the days Russell has chemo at the hospital, and I owe her more than I can say. And to this day, I'm not sure why she did it, except that she was kind and she could. If it takes a village to raise a child, it certainly takes one to help a man get cancer treatment. She ran that village like I never could. After a couple of cycles of treatment, I don't stay with Russell in the chemo ward as he sits on the comfy chair or lies on the bed taking his medicine. In the ward, we quickly run out of things to say to each other. I drive him there, but often leave the car in the car park so I can walk home, which I do, even in the rain, especially in the rain, because the water on my face and in my shoes helps me remember that this is real, that this is no dream. It's important to know that because often I wonder if this is the real world or not. Two and a bit months after we took the family portrait, I look at it one morning and realise that our little Poppy, even in this short amount of time, has lost some of the chubbiness of her cheeks and is looking more grown up. She and I go for a walk to the park, despite it being so cold, because she's needing some attention. When we get home, Russell doesn't look well. His temperature's up, and a few hours later, it still won't come down. We've been told that if this happens, we're to go to the emergency department because of the depletion of his white blood cells from the chemo. Any infection, even a minor one, can get really bad, really quickly. I drop the girls at Mum and Dad's and I get ready for a waiting emergency, but as soon as I tell the triage nurse he's a cancer patient, we're rushed through. This doesn't give me the comfort an express service in emergency usually would. They get him onto a ward, tell him he needs to stay overnight. He doesn't want to. And he wants me to support him discharging himself against medical advice. He's upset when I tell him no. He feels betrayed. We compromise on a visit from the girls in the early evening so he can see them. Poppy asks him if he's all right, and he downplays the whole thing. It's just a cold, he says, but they have to be careful. He tells her it's no big deal, but when you've got cancer, it can get serious. So they'll keep an eye on him, but it's nothing to worry about. It's just the cold he caught from her. And I look at her and I see her wince. Her cold? She made him go to hospital? She did this? She takes a step back from his bedside. Girls and I go home that night with him in hospital, and I'm ashamed because I'm relieved that he's not at home and I can sleep easier without him beside me. The house is so cold this winter and it's particularly bitter tonight. There's a draft I can't locate and the girls and I can't get warm, even with the heater on high and our sweaters and slippers on. A friend brings us soup and it smells good, but the girls complain we never get takeaway from the Thai place up the road anymore since everyone started cooking for us. They're sick of the cold and they're sick of the food, and I tell them how lucky they are to live in a place where everyone pitches in. But they're also sick of being grateful. I put the soup in the freezer and we get takeaway Thai, and I just hope no one sees the delivery guy at the door because I don't want to hurt anyone's feelings. 2 nights later, he's home. And it's even colder, somehow, with him in the house. Bear turns 11 on the last day of winter. She doesn't want a party this year, just wants to go to the movies with her friends. I can drop them down at the cinema and pick them up afterwards. When I suggest they all come back to our place to have birthday cake, she tells me she no longer likes cake. It's the last round of treatment. On a walk home from the hospital, I turn a corner and I'm hit by the smell of jasmine. That sweet, rich smell that envelops Sydney each spring. For the first time ever, the jasmine, which I love and wait for every year, makes me sad. For the first time ever, I grab at the vine winding its way through the fence of the church and I tear a fistful of flowers and throw them on the pavement. And I hope no one's seen me because it makes me look like I've lost my mind. I think I've lost my mind. It's a little over 3 months since the family portrait was taken. Bear now has bright red streaks through her hair after an experiment with some hair dye after school one day and a trip to the hairdresser to fix it, a visit I thought was too expensive, but her father uncharacteristically and indulgently approved. Sometimes I look at the photo and I wonder if there's something about the girl's eyes that makes them look younger than they were, more vulnerable or something. But no, it's just because they're changing so quickly, and even a few months makes such a difference now. Chemo finishes. There's a biopsy to see whether the treatment worked. The cancer seems to have reduced in the top part of the right lung, and Russell is ecstatic. But the oncologist explains it's spread over the bottom of the left lung, making that reduction in the right meaningless. It's not good news, but Russell remains convinced it is. So convinced, I wonder if the oncologist and I are missing something. We're told that Russell will go on to radiotherapy. And so he submits himself, and does so willingly because the cancer in the top of his right lung has retreated. And I submit with him, in a world of optimistic cheerfulness I give into. Because the cancer has reduced in the top right quadrant of his lung, and we will hold on to that because we must. He starts radiation a week later. 15 weeks after the family portrait was taken. Radiation is in a different building and he misses the chemo nurses. But again, he's the perfect patient as he lies in a room alone, the radiotherapist watching through a wall of glass, talking to him throughout the treatment via an intercom. Radiotherapy makes him tired. And his skin is red and dry, gets itchy and sore. Oftentimes we lie in bed and he wants to be held as he falls asleep, but It takes us a while to find a way to do this without making it worse. A new schedule of dinners and childminding is drawn up, and this time another roster of people who come and sit with him while I'm at work. Not all the time, he doesn't need constant company, but he's feeling more lonely, more fragile. Summer comes and life slows down a little as the kids get ready to finish up the year at school. Now I smell gardenia and frangipani in the air and I take the girls to the beach. We gingerly walk into the sea, still biting cold this early in the season. But we dive under the waves and while we keep moving, we can stand the temperature if we don't stay in too long. We let the waves carry us back and forth, in and out from the shore. Fish and chips for tea when we finished our swim. Russell is getting weaker all the time. The stairs are too much for him now, and getting up to our bedroom is too hard. My parents come round so that Dad can assemble a bed frame for us in the dining room. It'll become our bedroom for now. It's a proper Sydney summer day, hot and humid and the sky full of rain that just won't come. Russell watches my dad and I'm wincing at the slightly ungracious tone he's taking with him. My darling husband can be a bit short with people, rude in fact, and I wish he'd be nicer this afternoon. But I think Dad knows what this is all about. Frustration, a low-level fury that Russell can't do it himself. This helplessness has got to him. And there's no point me being embarrassed about it. Mum and I try to entertain the girls and I wonder why we thought it would be good for us to all be in this room at once to watch a bed being made. I see my mother looking at the family portrait of the four of us. Russell, me and the girls, dressed in our best, our hair tidy, smiles on our faces. She looks at it, looks at the girls, suggests she takes them for a swim. The girls can't get out of there fast enough. After the bed is assembled, after Bear and Poppy have come home and Russell has thanked my father in an embarrassed way for helping, we have an early dinner and we're ready for bed. I've tried to make the dining room as much like our old bedroom as I can, so I've brought down the chest of drawers and bedroom knick-knacks and photos of the girls that were on our bedside table upstairs. And there's the family portrait too, and I look at it the way my mother did earlier, and I see what I think she saw. A photo of a family trying to look okay. But already, by the time we took that photo, after the results of the test and after we told the children, we weren't okay. And I'm not sure how I could have done it, forced them to sit there, looking so frightened and trying to keep it hidden. And a few days later, Russell gets a terrible pain in his back. Of course he does. Because he always gets a bad back when he's stressed. And if this isn't stressful, this life we're leading now, then what is? The pain won't let up. And the summer gets hotter. and the air. Well, it seems harder to breathe.
Crescent.
Goodbye to All This is produced by me, Sophie Townsend, and Eleanor McDowell. The music has been specially created for the podcast by Jeremy Wormsley. Alan Hall is the executive producer. The consultant story editor from CBC Podcasts is Chris Oak. The BBC World Service podcast editor is John Minnell. It's a Falling Tree production for the BBC World Service.